Let's go.
Man, always, man, another Monday. Always bringing the vibe, starting off Mondays on the right foot, the right way. And if you're feeling down right now, I hope you get happy after this podcast. But I toast the live podcast, the most authentic, most organic podcast out here. Baby. Already know, man, your boy Dusko right here.
You already know, it's your boy Dylan.
And today we're sitting down with
J.J. Soria.
This is but a legend. Man, you've been putting
Are we just giving out that title now? You're a legend.
You've been in the game 20 years, about 20 years, right? You've been in shows, you've been in movies, Netflix series. And the one and only J.J. Soria, you know, giving it up.
Thank you.
But what does the word legend mean to you? Let's start off right there.
Well, I mean, I'll take it. Shit, I'll take it. But I think, how do I answer that question? To me, Emilio Rivera is a legend, right? And a big brother. Shit, Clifton Collins Jr. is a legend. I worked with him as well. I don't know, man. I just feel it. It's more so like it's not like you have to meet a certain criteria. I just think it's just the way I'll define it is you owning your own, possessing your own greatness, right? Oof. You know what I'm saying? Yes, like so in that case, I am a fucking legend because you know what I mean?
Yeah, no. I mean, we were talking about it earlier. You got to talk that shit to yourself.
Amen.
I am a bad motherfucker.
Hell yeah.
I am a legend. I am a king in this. And that's what I do. And
That's right.
But, man, thank you for making the time to sit down with us finally.
Thank you for inviting me.
Nah, man, it's one of the ones that, for sure, I wanted to sit down with you because I watched you on Gentrified. Mm-hmm. And your role there was, man, applause to you, man. Hats off to you. I know you got nominated for one of the best characters on there, too. But
I didn't even know that. Thank you.
He's like, shit. He's like, damn, hey, you know more about me than me.
If Google doesn't lie, fool, then Google was.
You know?
But, like, come on, we're Google searching you, too. Like, that's, I think that's also a flex. You get to research you a little bit more. But today we're going to find out a little bit more about your life and your journey in
In life.
Film industry. Yeah, in life.
A toast to life.
Oh. Man, you already know.
Yeah, yeah. Toast to life. Yeah, yeah.
Man, but you, first time I seen you, and if people are fans, I know there's a lot of fans out there, Sons of Anarchy.
Mm-hmm.
You got to play, you played a role in there too for a couple episodes, for an episode, and you've been in the industry for 20 years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's been that long already.
Damn.
Yeah. It's flown by, and it was cool to be a little glimpse in that show, which I think I had. Listen, man, I'm very transparent. People like what I say or not, but I feel I had so much more to offer that damn show. I wish they would have used my character more, but just I'm grateful to be a part of it for a hot second, work with so many talented dudes and friends as well.
Is that where you got to meet Emilio?
No, I met him just auditioning around the way first, and then matter of fact, I met him at. First memory I really have with him is sitting outside an audition, and then not long after that, he booked Sons of Anarchy, and that series regular role. And I was like, hell yeah, because he's been in the game for a minute. And I believe that's his. Correct me if I'm wrong. I believe that was his first series regular role.
He was a big part of that one, and obviously,
right. And I think Mayans it was a reoccurring.
Yeah.
And then, Sons of Anarchy it was a reoccurring, and then Mayans it was a regular, right?
Yeah. Well, mine is a big part of that.
Yeah, yeah. You know,
they knocked him off the chair, bro.
But, I mean, for me, that I think he was a big part of why the series was created, right? I mean, it's obviously, it's a collective. It's a collaborative art, acting, storytelling. But when you think the Mayans, you think Emilio, right?
And then you
Alvarez.
The Hot Cheeto movie, too.
And of course.
He played a big part in there, too.
Yeah, man. He's been doing it for me. Con Air back in the day. He's been around for a minute.
Let's take this back. We love this. We love hearing where we came from, childhood, couple little stories. But where did you grow up in for the people that don't know that are listening to it right now?
Originally, I'm from El Sereno. I was born in Boyle Heights. Lived the first 9 years of my life in El Sereno. And that's the area that I claim because I was like the most impactful, like traumatizing shit that happened to me in my life. So that's the area that I claim. But the majority of my life, I was raised in the San Fernando Valley, Mission Hills, North Hills, Granada Hills area.
Are you a single child,
brother? I have a younger sister. My birth father has another son that I know of. I've never met him. But yeah, I was in regards to like me and my mom in the household that I lived in, I was the oldest of two. So yeah.
How was it growing up right there in El Sereno?
You said trauma. You said most of your trauma.
Yeah. Like, listen, man, like so many other people. Well, first of all, you seeing your father hit your mother. That was the man that I adored. Doing something like that to my mother was very impactful, even more so than I realized. I realized the impact as I grew up, what it had on me, right? But in that moment, I mean, I adored my father as a child. And then when I saw him hit my mother, I disowned him. Literally, I remember saying, "You're not my dad no more." And as a little four-year-old kid, that's big. You know what I mean? Yeah, like, so to have that at four, and then right after that, got bit in the face by a dog that was my friend. The dog was named Johan. Literally could have ripped off my face. I have a scar on my cheek. Thank God the doctor did a good job of stitching up my face and have one through my eyebrow. The doctor said he could have ripped off my face if he wanted to, but luckily that wasn't the case. Missed my eye by the width of a hair. That was very traumatic, where I was scared of all dogs after that. And it was such a... It was a breaking of trust between me and my father with that. Again, not even realizing that's what it was in the moment, but that's what it was. And then a breaking of a trust between this dog that was my friend and then that attacked me for whatever reason. Out of nowhere, did that. So that was another breaking of my trust. And then, like so many other kids, been molested, you know what I mean? So dealt with that. And that was someone else that I trusted. My trust has been broken over and over. And it was like four. And then I had my head injury at six. So it was like four, five, six, seven. Then my stepfather came into the picture, who at that time was just like my mom was seeing this guy. And I hated him. So like all this pop, 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 get hit. And at the time, it wasn't considered traumatic. It was just life.
Yeah.
And
that's normal. Food, keep going.
It just was what it was.
Yeah.
And as you get older, I'd say like 9, 10, I would just tell myself, people have it worse. People have it worse. People have it worse. And I just kind of like rolled off my shoulder. Yeah. So the reason I claim El Sereno is because I went through all this, the heaviest shit of my life early on and while I lived in that area.
So during that time, going through all these punches, bro, punches of life that, you know, and as we say now, like no one should ever live through, right? That's part of it. Were you still smiling outside?
Yeah. Yeah. As far as I can remember, yeah. I've always had a big smile on my face until you get into your more your teenage years. You get more self-conscious about even a little bit earlier, because I was a little chubby for a while, and when I moved to the Valley, I used to get picked on about it, and I guess I was sensitive about it. So, I mean, I was literally praying in the shower, praying to God that I would lose weight, crying and shit in the shower, like, no, everybody's gonna lose weight. And I used to get in fights at school because of it. So I was a little self-conscious about that. But then as you get a little bit older, I wouldn't smile, referring to smiling, I wouldn't smile as much because I didn't like how my teeth were. I was like little fucked up teeth a little bit. But overall, through everything, I mean, I've been a pretty jovial personality.
Yeah.
You think that was just to mask it, or
who I am. That's okay. Who I am. As a matter of fact, I had to learn to be more like, I think it was my instinct to smile.
Mm-hmm.
And as you grow up and around the kids I was around, the guys I was around, like even when I fought, like when I used to pick fights, I wasn't a bully. I thought fighting was fun.
Mm-hmm.
And like I remember,
that makes two of us die. That makes two of us.
My mom even tells a story about how one time she was getting her hair done, and then someone told her, "You know, your son's picking a fight in the back of the salon," And she said, Joseph, what are you doing? I go, Mom, I go, I can kick his ass. I can kick his ass. Like, I would, I was picking a fight because I grew up watching, like, Rocky and all that shit. Like, I was inspired by that. So, and my grandfather was a fighter himself. And, again, very, he unfortunately passed away very early on in my life. He was my father figure. Had me throwing hands a little bit when I was little. And I just, I've always had that in me to want to fight. Got my first bloody nose, I think, at like 6 years old. Got this kid, I was staying with this lady and her kids. My mom, we used to a graveyard or whatever, so I'd sleep over there so I can get ready for school. And this one of the kids, her sons, had this like big, those big Rolex watches on the wall. You know what I mean? There's a clock. A clock on the wall. It looks like a Rolex. And he said, hey, yo, you want to see the watch? And I remember at the night before, they were asking me if I believed I can kick someone's ass. And I had to go to sleep. I was like, yeah. You know, yeah, I can kick his ass. I wake up the next morning, and I go in the room. They go, yo, come look at the clock. And I was like, oh, I go inside. They close the door, and I turn around, blah, and I get popped in the face by this kid. Like, that's good morning.
That was fucking woke up and chose violence, bro. Yo,
that was it.
Today I woke up and chose violence. No, I was waking up and chose violence.
He was training all night. You can tell, bro.
he was in the back. I'm gonna hit him like this. Nah. I gotta, just.
You know, I got popped in the face with my first bloody nose at 6. But yeah, so I thought fighting was just fun.
Normal, fun.
Yeah.
Something just to do.
I think I was actually, as I grew up, I was more terrified of getting home. Because I remember actually one time I got into a fight in the alley. And I got punched in the eye good. And I kind of started getting a black eye. And I was terrified. Not because I got the black eye, but because what that meant when I got home. My mom was going to see that. And I was going to get my ass kicked by my mom. For getting into fights. So I was like, oh shit, you know, I gotta. Exactly.
My dad's like, if he kicks your ass, you're gonna get home and I'm gonna kick your ass, bro. Yeah. So I was like, fuck, I had to win, bro. I fucking had to win.
No, it is one of those too, like just being scared. Like, my mom was always an enforcer in my house too. Mm-hmm. Like, my dad, when he's the last straw, like, if he walked in and we're still like in bad terms, oh, he's like, ¿qué está pasando? Chill, but my mom's that one that like.
Yo, she was the enforcer.
She was the enforcer, and it's always like, damn, what is my mom gonna say? Like, I remember I got in trouble one time in elementary because my friend beat up someone else in the restroom, and because I was in there, I'm a part of it, and I was like, they're gonna call your mom. No, don't call my mom. And Eduardo, ¿qué pasó? And I'm like, I'm all crying, dude. I threw up too, and I'm like, so he ended up throwing up. She's like, ahora vas a ir para allá, vas a hablar con la directora. But I was so terrified to just get in trouble by my mom. Now, like, I remember my first fight too. First fight, I was like, yo, hell yeah. After that, it's like.
When was your first fight?
Damn, I was eighth grader, bro. But it wasn't even like fighting. Like, not like. I remember I threw one punch and then the fool hugged me and then I watched a lot of WWE.
Suplex.
I was throwing that fool like a ragdoll.
You suplexed him and you got up and you're like, you know, like, doing the fucking the Hulk Hogan and shit. People's elbow and shit.
People's elbow and shit. No, and then I found out the fool started training boxing for you. He was like, I want a rematch. I was like, no. I was like, you're training, fool.
Hey, you fucked him up.
I was like, I'm not stupid, fool. Like, I know that right now you're going to fuck me up. But after that, now it's like, but now, like, just parents, bro. Like, parents are the enforcers. Uh-huh. You get in trouble over there, wait till you get home. It's another type of.
Real quick, what area did you grow up in?
Baldwin Park.
That's Baldwin Park?
San Gabriel Valley. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so what are we? 5 minutes away from West Covina, El Monte area, surrounding mm-hmm. areas.
And yourself?
Same thing, Baldwin Park.
Baldwin okay. Park, is Baldwin that how y'all linked up? Oh, okay.
I first lived in Monrovia.
No. Jose's like, no, so, not me, bro.
I met my guy right.
Silmar? Silmar?
No, South
Amani. Oh, South Amani, okay.
Yeah, no, I met my guy Jose here because my kid's mother, they're. Big group of friends that they had, and when I came into the picture, I mean, we became friends, went away, and then what we're doing right now, again, we bring people along the way that add value to us. Uh-huh. My guy here is one of my role dogs. I coached Dylan for a couple years in soccer.
He coached me
in
high school.
He became my assistant coach too. And then I coached with him in football, and shit, we met in life in a different part of our journey that now we just complement each other.
Dope.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we've known each other for the longest. It's just where we're at now is just we went through a lot of shit individually, and here we are. Just
I just want to give y'all a round of applause too, man.
Thank you.
Yeah. So that's what our team is, man. That where a lot of people didn't know is we've had a relationship prior to the podcast and the whole thing. Mm-hmm. When I started podcasting 2 years ago, Dylan was one of my guests. Jose was one of my guests. So it's just like we had a whole podcast prior to even hosting, being a photographer. Like, Jose's our manager. Like, we had a relationship outside of this.
Yeah.
And just now that we're in this, she can't break this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's the chemistry, the natural chemistry is what makes it work.
Mm-hmm.
And which is why you guys are successful and will continue to be.
Thank you, bro. Yeah. I mean,
it's just the beginning, man. This guy's getting started.
We're just tapping in. I would say, man, we just started.
Amen.
Why did you get into acting? So you're going through all this, like you're telling us your trauma. You're going through the ups and downs, the fighting, the triumphs, but why acting?
Uh-huh. And real quick, I may like pop out questions before I answer your question.
Yeah.
I go off on tangents and shit. We could bounce around the conversation, please do, jump back to the beginning, whatever. The reason I got into acting was this wasn't my dream.
Wait, you didn't?
Yeah, I didn't want to grow up. I didn't grow up saying, I want to be an actor.
Now the metric was like, what do you want to be?
Nah, never?
Nah,
fuck that.
Nah. What did you want to be?
I wanted to play for the Dodgers, bro. I wanted to play baseball. That I played baseball as a kid with Vince Vargas, who you just had on not that long ago, right?
Yeah.
Me and Vince were in elementary school together as well. Same classes, like third grade, I want to say maybe fourth and fifth, like several classes.
Yeah, I don't like him right now, bro. That last episode fucked me.
Oh, don't. I have to watch it still. Oh, yeah. So don't spoil it. we can still talk about this. But and it's so crazy how things come full circle, you know. Like when I saw him on the show, I was like, "Oh hell yeah!" Because I didn't know he was even in the industry at that point. So I was just so I was like, "Oh, what a!" You know, I say it's a small world; it's an even smaller industry.
Yeah.
But to answer your question, I've identified as an athlete first. I always say I'm not an elite athlete; I'm a just above recreational. Athlete,
somewhere in the gray area there.
Yeah, you know, like
so there's like regular athletes, and then there's professionals,
and then there's us. You know,
we just do it.
Hey, low-key, yeah, bro. Honestly,
you know, yeah, I'm just above average recreational athlete. You know what I mean? I work my ass off. You know, I'm mad determined. So what happened was kind of to sum it up. After high school, I wanted to continue to play sports, but quite honestly, my belief in myself in regards to even playing, at that time I was really more focused on football. I didn't play much in my high school team because there's just quite frankly better players than me on the team. And when I went to JC, I was like, man, if I wasn't playing there, I am very positive and motivated, but I'm also realistic. And I was like, I just didn't see it for myself to be able to make anything of it. Maybe I just didn't have quite frankly, the belief in myself to do it.
I think when you get to that factor, too, is having that it. You see that 1 in 1,000 athletes that you can tell they're born and bred for this and mm-hmm. like carry yourself a certain way. Like, been around college athletes and I've been around professional athletes. The professional ones that are, like, top tier no matter what the fuck. Man, they carry themselves mm-hmm. way different. Mm. But, I mean, it's that part of us, too. Like, well, I'll beat you, dude.
I've always had belief in myself.
Yeah,
you know, like, my work ethic is what's got me any success in my life. My tenacity. Just to keep going. And the reason I'm so confident is because I've been through, quote, unquote, real shit. Like, I just told you some of my traumas early on in my life. So, I'm like, man, if I can get through that shit. Playing a sport, doing all this acting shit, like that's easy, right?
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong, I still had insecurities as I went through that process as well. But just overall, I've had this self-belief in myself. And that in regards to when I was in JC and I was like, man, looking at the possibility of playing sports anymore, I was like, I gotta figure something else out. At that moment, I was trying to figure out career, right? And I was like, okay, well, you know, physical therapy, I've always liked the idea of being able to help people and have, as long as people got old and people got hurt, I'd have a job.
Yeah.
So I was like consistent work and you make a good living. And then I did an observation for that. Like I watched what a physical therapist does. I was like, this shit's boring. I can't just be here all day doing this. I wouldn't be happy. I was like, oh shit. I didn't think about being happy. Had to reevaluate my situation. And I pulled out some paper that I had wrote in high school. Where do you see yourself in 10 years? And I was like, for some reason, I put LA, working for the LAPD. I was like, all right, I'm gonna go try out for the LAPD, right? And signed up for that. And then come the background check, they're like, Mr. Soria, you realize you're on probation? And I'm like, well, I figured if I was gonna be in the system, I might as well be on the right side. You know what I mean?
Hey, but isn't it funny that they always tell you like, just tell the truth. The truth will prevail. And then you tell the truth, then sorry, you're fucked. Don't meet the criteria.
Yeah, right.
Fuck you.
I wrote an appeal letter. They're like, you have to wait a year for the response. I was like, a year? I can do so much in a year. So went back to my college counselor, and I was like, well, you know what? I've always been interested in understanding why people think the way they do, and so I was like, oh, let's try psychology as being my new goal. And she goes, okay, well, you need some extra units as well. You want to do painting, drawing, or theater? And I go, I've never been into the arts, man. I mean, even though I did, like, it's interesting because a bit of a side story. Growing up, my little sister was doing pageants and all this shit. And I used to tell my mom, we got to get her into commercials. Mom, we got to get her doing this, that. Shit. And there was this program called Robert Powers or something back in the days. And I told my mom to get, I think I heard it on Power 106. I might have heard, like, Big Boy or whatever talking about it. And took my sister and they signed me up as well. I'm like, no, not me. It's not for me. And that's actually the first time I met Mario Lopez back there. They had him there like signing autographs and shit.
Yeah.
And I was really pushing my sister. And lo and behold, here I'm doing it. But after that, again, my lack of interest in the arts, even though I did like little school plays or whatever they have to do for
it. Wasn't your main entrance.
It wasn't. So I go, painting sounds boring. Drawing I can't do to save my life. Fuck it. I'll do the theater class because maybe it'll be fun, entertaining. But I have this mentality where I say, how you do anything is how you do everything.
Correct.
So I sat up front. I listened to what acting was all about. The instructor, Susan Henshaw, talked about it. The words that stuck out to me was creating characters and telling stories. And I go, wait a minute. I can make a living creating characters and telling stories? And I just did the math in my head. And the math was, I'm a good-looking guy. Plus, if I just put forth the same work ethic that I put towards athletics, towards this, I'll figure the rest out.
Plus?
That was it. That was hey, dog, I wasn't real big on big equations. You know what I'm saying? It was very,
you know? Two plus two.
Those are the variables.
Two, 1 + 1 = 2.
I was like, my looks plus my work ethic equals success. It was that simple. Like,
let's not make it more complicated.
Yeah, you're like, damn, he's going to drop like at least 5.
No.
1, 2, 7.
Let's keep it simple, dog.
But simplicity is a big factor in a lot of things. People try to, think about this factor, this, so much shit, and you get lost. I'm like, no, my man's way. I went to college. I'm the only guy one of the only guys you ever meet that went 2 years to JUCO and still didn't graduate.
Really?
Yeah. Lack of, what? Like, I just, one, I started working at selling at T-Mobile, started making money there, and I said, well, I can make this much money and not have an education and run a store?
Deuces. Deuces, yeah.
Yeah, because I went to play soccer. And again, there was Mount Sac.
Okay.
There was other better people in front. And there's people that, I mean, at a JUCO, there's always the fools that come, rejects from D1 that come there, people that failed in D1 that come there. So there's always better people, right? But you also got to do your stuff and stand out, play your game, do whatever. And I went, I was like, all right, I want to play. I've been in the program, waited 2 years. And then in that last year, the same day, so this is funny, the same day of tryouts that was going to be my second year, all right, this is the year that you could probably make the roster, play, you know, you're on the good side of the coaches. It's the same day that it's to go work at T-Mobile, you're training, one or the other, what are you going to do? I said, well, I'm fucking broke right now. I need money. You know, I'm tired of living. Like, we would put gas in the car and be negative $30 in the car just to go to school. So I was like, what do I want to do?
Want to make money?
I was like, I'm going to go get paid to make this much? boom, started going to T-Mobile, and it worked out. It worked out good. One thing that, like, I even told my mom, I was like, dude, why'd you stop playing soccer? They're like, you've always wanted to do that. And I was like, yeah, but I know I left everything out there. Like, maybe I could have done something. Maybe I would have played. Maybe got to play one season. Maybe I got it picked up. But if I would have done that, then I would definitely not have what I have now and been through what I have now. So, like, my life now, if I could look back, man, I would not change nothing.
Well, they say, that there's that diagram I've seen on Instagram where it's like, they don't, success isn't like this, a straight line. It's right? It's the journey. That's why I say, you know, embrace the journey, the whole, because that's what, you need to go through all this crap in order to
like, I didn't know.
Excel.
I'm learning financial literacy a little bit more, but back then, bro, I had one car, and I started making more money, so I ended up giving it up, buying another one, just a faster car. So I kept, like, I'm like, now it's like, yo, like, you don't need to have the best car anymore, dog. You don't need to have a $700 payment on a lease. You don't need that just to look cool. For what? Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, you don't need to. So it's just, but if I didn't go through what I went through, now, like, I wouldn't even be able to have what I have now. Be able to endure it, too. Like, I think there's moments in our life that we get blessed with that if we would have had it back then, we weren't ready for it, and we would have just fucked it up.
Those challenging times are, you could be blessed with those challenging times, right? Because that's what, where you grow.
Facts.
I mean, I'm going through some challenges right now, and I got to embrace these moments because it helps you grow into your greatness. Man. So after I listened to what acting was all about, creating characters and telling stories, I did the math in my head and what made sense to me. And I go, I literally walked out of that first class saying, I'm an actor. Like, I didn't audition for nothing, didn't do nothing. I just made that decision in my mind. And I just figured out, again, with my work ethic, I'd figure out the rest. Someone told me about, you need to become SAG. I said, what's SAG? I just started doing extra work and trying to find an agent and I was taking scene study classes and just working on my ability, the craft, and trying to hustle and find an agent. And I had this little agent, hole in the wall agency that fell through after a little while. And then I just snuck into this one agent's office and ended up doing a cold read for her, hip pocket me. Like, she like, not sign me, but like just rep me for like 3 months, see how it goes type deal. And within that time, landed a Levi commercial. And then just bop, bop, bop. So started, you know, little by little, just working more and more until today.
For like your type of industry, is it important to first get like an agent or someone to represent you?
Well, you know, nowadays, I mean, shit, we're in a day and age where we're more independent seems the way to go, right? Like, make your own shit and put it out on YouTube, put it out.
Because, like, the streaming platforms are free.
Yeah. Kids ain't growing up trying to be actors no more. They're trying to be influencers, you know what I'm saying?
Exactly. Like, they want to be a TikToker.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's what, like, I know IG kind of went away from it, but, like, reels are obviously popping off. But, like, if you're not a big TikToker, then you can't really be considered an influencer, right? Because then everybody's like, oh, let me see your following.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, let me see how many people you follow, mm-hmm. how many people are seeing you, how many videos are viral and shit. Like people are really, like, it's funny, like, some, like, now, like, we met people and, like, yo, like, oh, let me follow you real quick. And then they tap to the IG and they're like, oh, let me see how many follow. Oh, damn, you guys are doing good. I'm like, nah, we've been doing good.
Yeah, you've been doing it.
Yeah, we've been doing good. But I know that some people just need that reassurance of, like, oh, you have X amount of followers, X amount of views. Okay, cool.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a very iffy thing. People can be great on videos on TikTok, but when they get to the outside world, like, to a different genre, some people can't perform. Like, it's tough.
I mean, listen, acting is a skill. You have to be able to be vulnerable. And it on the moment, if you will, not so much like, well, in the moment, on the moment, however you want to refer to it, be focused and just be able, like I said, be able to allow yourself to be vulnerable and still be technical at the same time. I remember when I first started acting, I was just all about just being raw emotion and just making sure that I felt real and not being so concerned about where the camera was or where my lighting was or whatever. But the more I did it, the more I understood how of course, you need to hit your mark. You got to, you know where the lighting is, where the camera is. Just have a sense. Just be aware.
There's more to it than just
you're definitely there with your fellow actors and but you're also in a dance with the camera, with your camera operator. It truly is a collaborative art form, you know. But again, at the beginning, I guess you could say early on, as with sports, I needed to just focus on just hitting the ball. Getting the solid bat on the ball, as opposed to as you play, you get more seasoned, and now you can know, okay, guys on third base, I want to hit a line drive or a grounder to left. That means being a lefty, I want to hit the ball to left field, so get the ball that way so he can run it in, you know, get a nice single. You know, put the ball into play in different spots as opposed to just hitting it. Mm-hmm. At the beginning, I just wanted to hit it, and that was me in the acting. Field, I just wanted to make sure that my shit was raw and real, and it felt good. And then as I got more seasoned, I was like, oh, okay, I had the confidence. I know I'm gonna be raw and real. Now let's make sure that it's getting caught on camera.
But was there like an on and off switch from the persona that you are compared to what your character is?
Well, I always say every character is me as that. I mean. Yeah, I may toss on an accent, which I'm not all that great with, but it's not my strong suit. But I try to do as little acting as possible, right? I don't try to act mad or act sad. If I'm crying, I'm really crying. If I'm upset, I'm really upset. I just understand, you know.
Like the scenes that you cried, is there something you replay in your head that makes you cry?
Yeah, I'll connect. So there's different methods. I'll use music. Music is a very powerful tool for me, where there's music, the energy of it, the tone. It speaks to me for certain scenes. Speaking of Gentified, Marvin Lemus, who was one of the co-creators of the production, the story, he told me, actually, I sent him a playlist of who I was listening to prepare for, I think it was either the whole season or a scene. And he goes, bro, that's what I've been listening to as I've been writing. I didn't know that. But I was just so in tune with the story that this music spoke to me, and it just so happened to be the same music that he was using to listen to while he wrote it.
Dude, and that character you played there was, man, like, people that watched the seasons, like, seeing you, like, progress and, like, it was a very powerful, powerful scene and very powerful moments in those seasons.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, like, that's one of the things where, like, I told them and I was like, yo, like, this is, like, I've watched this show from beginning to end and, like, I've seen your character and, like, a dad trying to make it for his kid was, like, wow, like, what the fuck?
And kind of he was flawed, right? Lock himself out of the house and try to get back in the second season where he locks himself out of the house and his kid's inside. And he's like, oh, shit, you know. Get the cop pulls up, you know. He's just trying to go outside and get some weed, right? And just deal with the situation, right? That was his vice. I use a lot of available reality. But I do, like I said, I try to do very little acting. Use acting as something to fall back on if need be. But for the most part, every character, there is an essence of me as that. That's what makes the characters I play unique.
Yeah.
I always say this, I'm more interesting than any character I'll ever play. Like, that's just the truth. So why not bring that to add to the character? It's only going to make it better. Right. And again, call that me being full of myself. Call that. I'm just telling you my truth. You know what I'm saying? Like I listen. I'm very flawed. I'm very, you know. I'm not saying I'm perfect by no means, but I'm perfect within my imperfections, if you will. Right.
Perfect imperfection.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I just bring myself to every character I play, and if it fits, it fits. If it doesn't, well, on to the next thing.
You ever get, like, heartbroken when you don't get a role?
I used to. Not so much anymore. There's roles I'm like, oh, shit. But it's kind of on to the next thing. Yeah. You know, it's listen, I may have been the perfect person for that role of Hentified, but I also have a perspective of there's five other guys out there that could have played that role. Is that the truth? I don't know. But I like to have that to kind of be quote-unquote humble. But also, like, whenever I'm not that guy, I'm usually in the conversation. Like, my boy, Jesse Garcia, who is perfect for Hot Cheetos, right? I told them, send me an offer. Like, I did my audition. I was like, yo, send me an offer. I'm ready. But after I saw, I was like, no, man, he was the fucking guy. And I hit him up. I told him, too. I was like, dog, that was your role. You fucking killed it. So I would have been, let's say Jesse was busy. He couldn't do it. Maybe I was number two. So my point is to say that there's many options. It's just a matter of, one, who's the right fit, who they can get, yeah, money-wise, who's available, right? Maybe they wanted, for Hentified, they wanted fucking Michael Pena, you know, and he wasn't available, yeah, so I was the guy to get it. But
second one up. Yeah,
you
yeah.
know what I'm saying? So I kind of take that approach to it so I don't feel heartbroken, if you will. And, I'll fit, because it's not just right being the right guy for the right, that story. It's also the people that you're working with. You want to work with like-minded individuals that you vibe with, mm-hmm, right?
Everything's just genuine.
Like, mm-hmm, you guys.
Yeah.
The reason this works is because the chemistry, at least I believe.
Yeah.
I think that's really big. And even when I came in for that audition too, I was like, look, I go, this is, when I read the script, I go, yo, this is gold. I go, if I do it, I'm going to kill it. Right, I just came in with that energy that they could have looked at me and been like, "This fool's.
This was crazy."
Next, you know what I mean?
Hey, before you start,
yeah. Mm-hmm. You're gone, bro.
Just go,
because you're done. You're done. We've seen enough. We've seen enough.
Hey, my name is. Thank you.
And either you take the role back.
Either you get my energy, you get my personality, or it may be too much, or you don't get it. Right. Mm-hmm. So I prefer just to be myself. And I thought I had some value. I saw what I could bring to this story.
Yeah, which is really,
I saw what was already there.
Yeah.
And then I go, oh, give me this, bro. Cause I felt like when I was in conversations I've had, I say it was like, you guys remember DuckTales? You guys are familiar with the show called DuckTales. It was a cartoon back in the day, probably before your time. But there was this cartoon called DuckTales, and
it's way before my
time. in the intro, their uncle Scrooge McDuck or whatever, he was rich and he would jump into the pile of coins, and that's what I saw this script as, a big vault of treasure coins, and I was the duck, and I was gonna jump right in, and I was like, oh, give me that. So I just felt like I could tear that shit up, yeah, right? And that's what I did.
Now, is for being an actor, obviously there's different roles that you're going to play. There's different shows you've been a part of. Is there like a thing where like you have to keep your image, your body a certain way to kind of be available for whatever comes your way, whatever gets thrown at you? Or like how does that work?
At least I'll only speak for myself and say, I mean, I'd like to be on the fitter side just because that's a lifestyle choice. And I prefer to play characters like that, like, you know, I have to be fit. There hasn't been a role that's come my way where they're like, yo, you need to gain some weight or lose weight.
Yeah, like when we read those, like,
oh, bro, those are crazy.
50 pounds or lost 75 pounds to play this role and got really into him for like the last year. Like, damn, like, there's people that really get into, I mean, because it's a livelihood, right? Like, mm-hmm, there's going to be roles along your journey that, hey, in order for you to play this, we want you, but you have to lose this.
Well, if, like, I would love to pay Julio Cesar Chavez for, I posted a picture of, yeah, him recently, and it looks like me, bro. I just got to lose, and I'm a little chunky, so I lose some weight. I mean, he fought at 135. I don't, I quite frankly, I don't think I can get down that low. I probably get to like 145. Yeah, he was a smaller guy, but I have, dog, that picture, it's me, right? And so for something like that, I would have to lose weight. And if I can get down to 135, great. But that'd be a hell of a challenge. My point is to say, if need be, that's something I would do it for, you know? Yeah.
Would you shave your head?
But I have, huh?
Would you shave your head?
Oh, yeah. I've been bald most of my life. Yeah. Most of my life.
Would you shave your head?
For real?
Yeah.
Fuck it. Fuck it.
I've already done it, actually.
Through the pandemic, I don't know if you guys, obviously you guys didn't, but like, I shaved my whole head. Twice.
Yeah. Midlife crisis or what the fuck?
Nah, es que wey, es que no me dan de comer. Fuck. Nah, I'm
Like, I know, like,
I've done it for a role before.
Like, I know my friends, they all went, like, bald, but it's because they're already losing hair. Uh-huh. Like, their dad is bald, and they're like, dude, we're losing hair, so fuck that. We beat it to the point.
I barely turned 24, yeah, but I'm still got a shitload of hair.
Beard, like redneck type of beard, and I'm like, damn, fool, I grow patches, fool. Sorry. I'll
cut some here and put some up here, fool. Fuck it.
Damn, but to my point is, like, there's always going to be different roles that, like, you're going to go for. Do you, now where you're in your career, do you pick and choose what you're trying to aim for? Or is this like what's best?
I'm still looking for the page. I mean, it's like, I'm not to the point in my career where I could just sit back and everything's just coming my way.
Yeah.
Right. I still have to audition. I'm still waiting for my agent to get me opportunities. I also do have people calling me up as well and saying, yo, would you do this? You know, either directly or indirectly, opportunities will come where I don't have to audition. But yeah, so it's a bit of both.
What makes you happy?
Well,
in acting and outside of acting.
Well, I'll say this in regards to my career, where I feel I have the most value, or what makes me happy is, I love action, right? Because I told you I grew up playing sports all my life. So I need to sweat. I need to, I need to feel like I earned my paycheck. And I did a series for Sony Crackle called The Oath. And, oh, man, it was, we put so much. I earned my paycheck on that motherfucker because, like, we were dead tired at the end of every day. They're, like, unhentified and stuff like that, maybe on some days I'd be dead tired emotionally, but it wasn't like I physically ran myself through it. You'll feel a little fatigued just because you're putting yourself through an emotional scene over and over again.
Yeah, emotionally tired is a lot different than physically.
To touch that topic, as an actor, obviously you play a lot of, there's a lot of personas that go into it. There's a lot of stress mentally. What does mental health play into your roles or anything? Like, how important is it?
Well, I think your mental health is important, period. But, okay, so I guess the best way I could answer that is maybe I've with the Oath, my character was going through it. He's a dirty cop, but loves his family, has a daughter, and he's doing everything for his family, right? And he's dealing with the narcos and the FBI are involved, and it's this high stressful situation. So I would take my work home a lot of nights, just because I'd be in it all day long, all day and night. And once I finished that that production, I needed to go and get away after that. I needed to go on a trip. Yeah. And just, like, I'm not doing no auditions. I'm not doing nothing. I'm just going to go live life. Just go pura vida. I went to Costa Rica right after that and did it up, dog. And actually, right after that is when Hentified came. But, yeah, it was for my mental health and everything. I was like, let me just go live it up and not do anything related to work. And go scuba diving and go be the adventurer that I am.
So is that like the way to cope with things in that sense of like bringing your mental health into it, is going to go do exhilarating things, fun things that make you happy? Or like, has there been a moment like where you kind of like sat sat down or kind of reflected and you were like, fuck, this is too hard?
No, there hasn't been a moment where I felt anything was too hard. I've definitely, it's important for me to remind myself of who I am. And you know, like I pound my chest a lot. Like that's something that's like a trigger for me to be like, yo, you've been through shit. So like, yeah.
Get up.
Remember who you are, motherfucker. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? But there hasn't been anything that's led me into any depression or anything like that. But again, I think it's very important to be mindful of the thoughts that are going through your mind constantly, right? Mm-hmm. You have to be mindful. And again, right now, I'm going through some challenging shit financially right now. I mean, not to put all my business out there, but I try to set myself up. Economy took a shit, and it led me to, I was sitting pretty for a while, and now I'm in a position where I'm like, oh shit, I need to make money. Because I haven't been vulnerable in a long time in that regard. And by trying to set myself up, I ended up shooting myself in the foot, kind of. And not kind of, I did. And that hurt because I did it to myself. And so I'm like, oh, part of me is saying, I'm stupid, I'm this, I'm that. But I have to pound my chest and remind myself, motherfucker, you've been through all this shit in your life. You got this shit too. You feel me? And so, and again, I'm not doing that just to feel better. I'm doing that because that's the truth. Mm-hmm. So you got to get uncomfortable in life. You got, whether it's in the first, you could do it by going to the gym and pushing yourself physically. Because when you're in the gym, or even when I'm in the gym, I'm pushing myself. I'm talking to myself. Dog, I'm shit. I remember when I was doing this show called Army Wives. It was my first series regular role. And I had actually, right before that, I made a decision, bro. I had, because for a long time, for 10 years, I worked with special needs kids, with kids all across the spectrum. And I no longer felt like I was serving a purpose. I felt like I was babysitting. And that was kind of like depressing. I would clock in and I would look at my watch as soon as I clocked in. I'm like, God damn, I don't feel like I'm serving a purpose anymore. This has just become a job. Yeah. And that was depressing. And I go, well, motherfucker, you said you believe in yourself in regards to this acting thing. How much do you really believe in yourself? Stop doing this. If this ain't making you happy.
All in.
All in. Okay. Life is a gamble. I'm all in. I have it inked in my skin. So I took that gamble and I stopped. I retired from that occupation, took out that safety net of that job, and I said, I'm going to make my money just acting. And manifested the opportunity for this gig to come up that came out. I was in the gym when they called. I was in the gym working out, and I got this message, yo, audition at Disney in a matter of hours. I run home, didn't even shower, ran home. Go to my printer. My printer don't work.
Damn.
Jesus.
Can't print out the sides for the audition. So I'm driving to the audition, looking at the sides on my phone, trying to go over that shit and not crash. Get there. Go look at the sides. Go in. Boom. I get the call back the next day. Boom. I get the role.
Yeah.
Like that. Boom. And next thing, I'm off to go do this series. At that moment, it was like a 4-episode arc. But I needed the money too. Like I was in a moment where I needed that money. So financially, I was in a bad spot. And in that moment, it wasn't the best case scenario, right? But I knew who I was, stepped into that moment, and I landed it. And so that's just one example of a moment where I could look back on in my life, even like, because right now I'm vulnerable and I've thought about talking to my girlfriend and be like, yo, man, this is where we're at. This is where I'm at. And I have to remind myself who I am and be like, I got this. And in my gut, that's, I know I got this. But doubt creeps in now and again, but you have to filter out those, you have to recognize it, acknowledge it, and then, remind yourself who you are with positive self-talk, yeah, and manifesting what you want. You have to see it to believe it, right? And you have to, and then which provokes action.
And you can wish upon upon a star, you can wish for better days, but if you don't have any action behind it, then you're not going anywhere.
Yeah.
And that's the difference maker between a lot of people that are in the industry or in the profession. There's the people that have always wished and hoped to one day do this, and there's the people that wished upon it and took action behind it. And what a lot of people, again, people don't understand, like, yo, like, you're going to go through a lot of trials and tribulations, the highs and the lows. You just got to be ready for whatever comes. And when I say be ready, you don't know what's coming. But, hey, make sure you don't give up. Make sure you absolutely keep on going.
To that point, I feel like, especially in this day and age where a lot of people are embracing, like, this victim mindset.
Yeah.
Listen, man, life ain't fair. But you have to take what you're going through as those challenges and jump over those hurdles. That those moments, like I say, it's, I don't know if this is the best way to describe it, but if you haven't been through shit, the moment you go through something, you're gonna get knocked over by that wave. But if you've gone through something, you stay the course and you persevere. Like, again, the reason I'm so confident is because I've been through shit, because of the heartache I've been through. Yeah. I wouldn't have wanted my life. I'm happy I've been through everything I've been through because it's made me who I am, and I love and I'm proud of who that person is. I love who I am, and I'm tenacious, dog. I'm a beast. Because I've been through that shit. So don't look at yourself as, oh, woe is me because I went through all this shit. You know, you should be like, nah, motherfucker, I've been through that. Mm-hmm. I've been through this. And imagine when I got everything. And that's what's going to get you everything because you've been through that. As opposed to somebody who's had everything served to them on a silver platter.
Yeah, it means so much more to you because you've earned it. And you've earned every single fucking step of the way. And no matter what he said, what she said, what they say, ain't no one can take me down from this. I'm him, dog. Like, whatever.
I'm him.
I'm whatever you think exactly. I am, I'm him.
And at the same time, it's just like you build it yourself. Once you get dropped out, you can redo, you can reconstruct that right away.
Yeah, put the lion in the jungle. Put him in any situation. He's gonna be a lion.
Mm-hmm.
But our boy Jose said it, you gotta be a wolf. A wolf doesn't perform in the circus. He keeps on going, even though he has to be alone. That's the thing. Some people forget that. Being in your craft, being in your journey, your purpose, hey, sometimes that shit gonna get lonely. Mm-hmm. Maybe not everybody's gonna stick around and believe in what you're doing. Like, you're gonna, maybe you don't get the payout right now, you don't get the role, and you haven't, whatever the case is. Dude, just give it up.
Oh, bro, people are always there when you're winning. When you're winning, people are like, yeah, dog, you did shit, yo.
Feel it, celebrate. What happens when it's all gone?
When it's dry, when you go on that dry spell, you know what I'm saying?
There was one of Rick Ross, he was doing an interview. They're like, yeah, there's one time, oh, it was Fat Joe. There was two private jets full of people, dog. And we were living life lavishly. This was a time where we were going up with Big Pun and everybody. He's like, but one of my friends was like, Joe, like, this isn't it. He's like, so one day I just said, yo, I don't got it like this no more. Like, that's it. Everybody that's in my team right now stuck it out. Everybody else that left, they gave up. Mm-hmm. It's that thing. When you're up, everybody's here. Everybody wants to be around. When it comes down to kind of rehearsing lines, when it comes down to working on the back end of stuff, on the business, on your personal stuff, who's there? Not a lot of people going to be there. Like, we said this many times, and we just said earlier, we used to be in a room full of like 10, 12 people because we thought that's what success was. Success for a lot of people is being out, partying it up, being surrounded by like tens of 20 people and more. But in reality, when you got to go back to the business, back to work on the internal shit, and you may have a room, maybe two people, three, four, five people. They're coming to add value. They're not coming here to take. So when, what did Conor McGregor say? Like, I'd rather eat with the people I starve with.
Mm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Then when everything is up, shit, then we all win. But the people that are there at the lowest ain't going
to
be.
And it's also important for you to be the person that you need too, right? Mm-hmm. Be there for others. Be whatever you feel like you're lacking, be that for other people.
Yeah.
And that also goes to show you how strong you are as well. I'm very supportive of my friends. And even if it's not out there in public, it's hitting people up and reminding them who they are.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not gonna mention any names, but I mean, I could, if you were to ask around, I've definitely been there for plenty of people to remind them who they are, and then they'd be like, oh, that's right. That's
it. Yeah, that self-dialogue is super important, dude.
And, absolutely.
And shout out Miguel, that was just with us earlier. He was, I need to tell myself those things that I need to hear. Mm-hmm. So I don't have to wait for other people to tell me that I'm proud of you, the keep going. Yo, you are great. You are worthy. If you tell yourself those things, bro, you don't need to hear this shit from anybody else.
Or just in general, the congratulations to yourself, bro.
Like, it's dope. Like, I need it, bro. Like, I've always needed it. Mm-hmm. But now being confident in who I am and what I do, I don't need it.
I don't need
it. You don't need it. It's nice to hear. It's nice. It feels good, but you don't need it. But again, speaking about positive self-talk, it's just as important to be aware of the negative stuff you say to yourself, because that could be poison. Listen, I've dealt with weight, like, for myself, like, in my own weight issues, if you will. Like, yeah. I'll be like, oh, I'm getting chubby, this and that, and I'm not even chubby yet. But I keep talking about it, and all of a sudden, I end up creating it. You know, I'll start eating more and doing all that stuff. And then I look in the mirror, I'm like, oh, shit, I put on some weight. So, and it hasn't happened once or twice. It's been a pattern in my life. So I'm like, oh, shit, you gotta be careful about what you're saying. And if you say something negative, reinforce it with positive self-talk. You know what I'm saying? Just shake that shit out. Be like, no. Again, like I keep saying in this interview, remind yourself of who you are. So if you... just because you're a positive person doesn't mean... The reason I'm so positive is because I have to be, dog. Like, there was so much negative talk in my head for a long time.
All the negative events that you had to go through, all the traumatic things you had to go through, mm-hmm. you have, how they say, you have every right to be a victim. You have every right to sit down in a fucking corner and say, well, I'm not worthy. I'm just going to be this because everybody told me I was only going to be this.
Or choose to be your own hero. I hear you, but choose to be your own hero.
Just like how Miguel said, bro, it's just you got to change the point of view.
Change the
narrative in your own mind.
Yeah, what was that? There was the actor is like, I'm my own hero in 5 years, mm-hmm. because in 5 years I want to be this person that I've always imagined to be. But once I get there, I'm also my hero in another 5 years, and I'm always progressing. Because the person I am now, I want to be this other person as I progress. I want to be a better person, a happier person, more fulfilled, you know, more giving. But in order for me to get there, I got to make sure I do everything that I need to. The work, the internal work, the self-dialogue, the positivity. What am I feeding my mind? What am I doing? Who am I around? It's like we've always said it, like the Spanish, like our parents, dime con quién estás, te dirán quién eres. So if I'm around losers in a sense, I'm going to be the sixth. But if I'm around winners, motivated, and purposeful people, I'm going to be the sixth person to be purposeful, fulfilled, and happier. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I hate being sad, bro. It's part of our nature. We're going to be sad. We're going to have moments. But it's how I look at it.
But it's a moment.
It's a moment. Not a bad life. It's just a moment. But I used to think, man, my life is fucked, dog. This is it.
And if that, but what will happen is, if you keep telling yourself that, that will be your reality.
Exactly.
Yeah. But as you're going through shit, like, say, I'm the shit, you know, I am him, and this and that.
And it turned into other things, too, of, oh, like, he's sad, he's whatever. Like, fuck it, fool, let's go drink, dick. Don't worry about it, let's go party, let's forget about this.
Run away from it.
Mm-hmm. But when you come back to it, or even being drunk, getting home by yourself, you're in a
It's going to hit you twice as harder, bro. Yeah, it's going to hit you twice as hard.
You're in a bigger hole, like... I'm not helping you, fool. How about we go eat? We go talk about this. How about we, hey, fool, you're worthy, dog. You gotta do the work and whatever you need, I'm here. But you gotta be able to walk that walk yourself. I can hold you up only so much. And imagine someone with their dead weight just trying to letting you drag. No mames, te vas a cansar. It's like, yo, like you're great. You gotta believe it, bro. Don't be what everybody thinks you are. Mm-hmm. Be who you know you are.
Or don't let people tell you who you are. I mean, you tell yourself who you are. And, you know what I'm saying? Let people, listen, if people think you're great, that's cool. If people think you're something else, that's fine too. But who you believe you are, that's the narrative that matters most.
That's the important one.
That's the truth.
That's all that matters.
Yes, sir.
That, Title of this, Self-Dialogue.
I remember when I was working at the school and this one kid saw me reading a theater play for class. Yeah. And he goes, what's that? I go, oh, it's a play. He goes, you're an actor? I go, he goes, what have you been in? I go, I haven't been in nothing. He goes, oh, so you're trying to be famous? I go, and just in the moment, I go, nah, I'm already famous. Just no one knows yet.
There you go.
You know, like.
What do we always say?
We're not famous, we're impactful.
We're not famous, we're impactful.
Yeah, I've heard you guys say that before.
But it, someone was like, damn, you guys are famous. I'm like, nah, bro. Like it's cool. Like, if I said to you, if to be very honest, if I told you, nah, bro, I never wanted to be famous, I'm lying. Mm-hmm. I've always wanted to be known. But it was just a matter of fact. It was just a matter of time of finding out what I wanted to be known for. I don't want to leave this world and be like someone that could have done this, that should have done this, that had the potential to do it. I want to be known for someone that did do this shit, that did make an impact, that did make a change, and left his kids something for when he's gone, not just a memory of what his dad could have been. Like, fuck that. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm living my purpose, and I had to figure out what my purpose was. And it's like Steve Harvey says it, do that thing that keeps you up at night. I'm doing the thing that keeps me up at night, and I don't give a fuck what anybody got to say about it because it's my purpose. Right now, you're not applauding, but down the road, don't come back and say, hey, bro, it's cool. It wasn't your time to come and support me, mm-hmm. but I don't need that support because my support comes from within, and I'm surrounded by the right people that came to add to my life that also I need to show up for them as much as they show up for me. You know what I mean? Like, that self-dialogue that I needed to tell the person in front of that mirror, like, fool, you're a bad motherfucker, dog. You've been through shit. You've had to go through this to be this.
And if this resonates with you, don't dim your light or, like, because I remember when I would talk like this about myself in front of other people, and I'd kind of feel the energy of, like, who the fuck does this motherfucker think he is, right? And I had to ask myself, well, who the fuck do I think I am? You know what I mean? Yeah. I had to ask. I'm like, am I blowing smoke up my ass? And I, in my gut of guts, I'm like, nah, man, this is who I believe I am. And it's not so much that it's not a reflection of who you are, it's that they don't get it because they don't see themselves that way. And I want those people to feel themselves that way. Like, yep. I want people to feel the way I feel about myself. I want you to feel the same about yourself. Yeah. Because just because I believe that I'm the shit doesn't mean that I don't believe that you're the shit.
Yeah.
Excuse me, let me say that again. Mm-hmm. It's not that I believe I'm the shit and you're not the shit. I just believe that I'm the shit and I want you to believe the same about yourself. Yeah. That's what I'm saying. You know what I mean? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Being in a table full of kings and queens, yeah, just as confident.
It's just tapping into your light, man, and tapping into your I am him personality, right? Yeah. That's what it is. And so shine that, express that, go love yourself, and then share that love with the world. That's what I say. Love yourself and then share that love with the world. And when people get touched by it and they're like, oh shit, I need to feel the same way about myself. Or, you know, they're inspired by it to do that for themselves. Right?
And the haters will always think that when you're when you are in that mentality of the I am him, it's egotistic.
Yeah. And to those haters, yo man, I can't wait for you to feel about yourself the way I feel about me.
You understand.
Just change your environment and you'll figure that out.
Yeah, start paying attention. Pay attention to the music that you're listening to. Pay attention.
You're sharing your dreams.
Absolutely.
If we didn't give a fuck about you, if we didn't care about your success and your well-being, you tell me, yo, I'm gonna play this role. I'm gonna be the biggest actor. You're full of shit, bro. Nah, bro, come on, bro. Let's go do this instead. Nah, bro, how about we change that narrative and be like, yo, what can we do to help you? Mm-hmm. What can we do to, like, be that support system for you? It's just people tell big dreams to small-minded people, to people that are just enclosed. So when you tell big dreams like this, like, we're going to be one of the biggest podcasts in the world, they know my miss.
Like, you're from Baldwin Park, bro. You're not going
to
make it.
But it's one of those things, like, I don't need you to believe it. I believe it. Mm-hmm. I'm good.
The way I look at that too, I mean, even when I first started acting and I told my family about it, not they weren't necessarily negative about it, but I could definitely tell that they weren't. We got your back, baby. Skeptical, you know what I'm saying?
It's like, yeah, I mean,
well, make sure you get a backup. You know what I mean? This and that. And I go, oh, and I understood it. I go, it's just because they love me and they don't want to see me fail.
Yeah,
right.
That's it.
In my own mind, I could have took that one of two ways. I could have been like, oh, man, they don't believe in me. And maybe I don't got it or whatever. And, but thankfully, I had a different mindset where I said, it's okay. You just need some convincing. Once I got some experience under my belt and stuff on my resume, you know, then you'll see and you'll come around.
Yeah, I mean, for like our parents and our family, it's just a matter of like, they love us. They're always going to worry about your well-being of if tomorrow you're good, in a week, in a month, you're going to be good. So they're always going to have that worry. It's up to us to make that dream into reality and show them like, hey, mom, dad, like, hey, we're good. You know, this is a trial and tribulation thing. This is an ups and downs type of thing. It's not linear. But it doesn't matter if I put my work, if I do what I need to do, it's gonna prevail no matter what happens. Like, that's just a part of it. There's one thing that you said earlier that I do want to bring up. You went through a brain injury. You went through a head injury. And you said before the podcast that you forget a lot of things. But after speaking and, like, having this conversation, like, you remember a lot of the things that have happened to you.
Just glimpses,
yeah. Yeah, like, in your life. Remembering all these things, it's a big part of your life and who you are now in your journey. So if you could speak to, like, the 10-year-old you, like, what would you tell him right here sitting where you're at?
Stay the course. You are that motherfucker. Like, you are who you believe you are. You know, I've always been doing this since I was little, bro. You know what I'm saying? I've always been doing it. I still do it. Yeah. You know? You are that motherfucker. Don't doubt yourself. That's what I would tell him. Keep believing in yourself, man. Stay the course. Stay the course. Everything you've been through, everything you're going through, everything you have been through and you're going to go through is just making you tap into your greatness, and you're growing into your greatness because of that. Yeah, man, that 10 years old, I was a little chubby kid that's been 10 years old. You're making me think. I remember that guy. I remember that kid, chapped lip, all like this and shit. You know, little chubby with his Michael Jackson shirt on, fucked up Halloween costumes. You know, like mom made Halloween costumes and shit. Getting picked on for being a little chubby. The girl that he liked didn't like him. You know what I mean? Like all that stuff. That kid, you're going places, man. You're going places. Just stay with it. Just stay with it. You are him. That's what I tell him.
That's right. Yeah. I love that. I love that, man.
There's so much. Power that comes behind what you just said right now, because you remember who that kid was, but you're also seeing it from the third person perspective of who you are now.
It's like, I'm actually holding back the film. I'm like, you know what I mean? I'm like, oh, the more I think about it, I'm like, oh, dude, whoo, yeah.
It's a safe space, homie. It's a safe space.
There was a lot of pain, though.
Oh, absolutely, bro. I mean, I related to Robin Williams again. Like you asked me earlier, have you always had that smile? Yes. Because I want to say my mom instilled a lot of love in me. I'm very blessed with a loving, loving sweetheart of a mother. And she did her best. I had to teach myself how to be a man, you know, growing up. I had my stepdad was there and a great supporter, and I love and respect him, thank him for all the time, but he wasn't my father figure. I had to grow up and teach myself how to be a man. And that was something I'm very proud of. And yes, I went through a lot of pain, and I felt so much shit, and I had to put out that smile. Listen, I've had those thoughts of suicide and all this shit that people go through, crying in the car on my phone, my cousin and shit, like, about whatever I'm going through and saying that stuff, but it was a moment. And the fact that you're speaking about it, that's good. Get it out and reinforce it with positive self-talk. Again, I had to be positive to get me through whatever I was going through. But then eventually, it wasn't just something to get me through it. It was who I am. You feel me?
Is during that time, like, if you kind of, like, put yourself back in that place, like, only reason I'm saying this is because was there a message that you've always wanted to hear, especially during that time?
Was there a message?
Like, you needed to hear from somebody, from your mom, from people around you, like, you've always just, like, your body, your mind, your soul just needed to hear?
I can't say that I was seeking it from anybody else. I've always I've always believed. I listen, man. Even though I'm not religious anymore, I've always looked for the answer. I felt that everything I needed dwelled within inside me. You know, so I would always seek for the answers in myself, and also, so where a lot of people I feel they reach out for answers outside themselves, whereas to God or to a book or to somebody else or to a companion, I say, no, you're enough. Look within inside yourself. Figure out your own shit. You can, not to say not to listen to what other people have to say, because you can gain there's value with what you guys do by putting out people's experiences through that. You can resonate with you, but then take that into your own. Evaluate that within your own mind and your own emotions, and dig into yourself and believe that you're enough to get through it, whatever you're going through, and figure it out for yourself. How does that apply to you, right? How does whatever message you're hearing resonate with you? So I can't necessarily say I was looking for someone to. I mean, definitely there was times actually, you know, I would pray and all this and the other, but when my belief in that was no longer, I was just going into myself, and I say that, you know, there was a moment where I've even said that we all are God, we're our own God. How that speaks to you, you know, that God dwells within all of us, right? And so I would go into that and speak to whatever that voice was, and that's who gave me the strength to persevere and get through whatever I was going through.
You're powerful, dog.
Hell yeah, bro.
Like, I want you to.
The first thing I ever. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No. Go ahead.
The first thing I ever wanted to do as a kid, I want to be a preacher, and I realized I am. And listen, maybe there is a power. I don't know shit. If there's anything I've learned is that I don't know shit. All right. So
as we go, yeah.
Right, and so maybe I'm just being a vessel. And this higher power, if you will, is using me to speak to others, because I've been very fortunate and blessed. I feel very blessed to have impacted many people's lives. Yeah. I feel the need to do it. Like, yeah, it's like you said, your purpose, whether it's been through the platform of social media or in person, I've said things and have spoken to people, and it's hit them the way it needed to.
Yeah.
And so I feel like I am a preacher, but it's not maybe the word of God. It's just, it's a preacher of whatever you need to hear. You know, like, there's so many times people would be like, yo, I need to hear that, dog. And I even call people, and I've had that you called at the right time, dog. I go, yo, I didn't feel like, it wasn't like I got, I got to call somebody. It wasn't like I got the bat signal and I got to hit them up. It was just, for whatever reason, hit so and so up, and it's happened to me too.
Things happen, especially now. Like if we look at it, things happen for the right reasons at the right time at the indicated time. Mm-hmm. Like maybe a couple months ago when we reached out, maybe that wasn't the time to sit down, mm-hmm. and maybe right now it was. And I know right now it is because of the way the conversation is going. Yeah, we can get it to acting, we can get it to the roles and all that stuff. But that's not the course of this conversation. The course of the conversation is what has happened in our life that has made us who we are now. And now we're able to speak on this. And if it helps you, man, I'm glad. And if it don't help you, man, I'm still glad. But I'm just speaking out of my mind, my soul, my body. Mm-hmm. And you take it however you want. These are just what worked for us.
Yeah.
Whatever works for you might be
hopefully there's something from this conversation people could take away, and if it resonates with them, I like to share this. Be aware of what you're listening to, who you're listening to, who the energy you're surrounding yourself with, the thoughts that go through your head, positive and negative. And I always say, I see you life, people, the life, God, universe, however you want to word it, will present opportunities to you to get a message. Life is always talking to you, bro. Yeah. You're thinking about something and then a song plays. Bam. You're thinking about something and get a phone call from somebody.
Or you see something on your feed or whatever the case is. You're like, damn, I was just, what the
fuck just thinking about that. You're in some negative headspace, and all of a sudden you get into a car accident. You're like, fuck, you know, and you keep going down that way, or like you're in a positive space, and then something happens, and it was like, so when those moments happen, I go, I see you, life. Yeah. I see you, life.
I see what you're trying to do right now. Yep. Yeah, I mean, again, just being graceful and appreciative of everything that's fucking happened to us. Without every fucking event that has ever happened to us, mm-hmm. we wouldn't be who we are, and we would not be able to speak the way we were speaking to other people, because then our message wouldn't have any weight behind it. We would just speak out of like, you know what, I think if we would have gone, nah, fool, like, let me tell you what I've been through. Let me tell you what helped me, and if it works for you, power.
You said a big thing right there, gratitude. Gratitude is the attitude, and always go back to gratitude. I'm grateful for everything I've been through because, again, like I said earlier, it's created the man I am today, and I love and I'm happy about the man I am today. Be grateful for the fact that my father wasn't there, you know, growing up. And because who knows, if he was there, my dad was getting into some shit back in the day. That maybe if he was around and I would have got caught up into that, would I even still be here? You know, but would something else have happened to me? Right, I gone down another route just because of that influence.
Yeah.
So be grateful for the things you've been through, positive and quote unquote negative. Okay. Learn from everything you've been through, and just always remind yourself to be grateful, even though sometimes it may seem like hard to find gratitude in those things. Find it and be genuinely grateful, man. There as a kid, my mom used to tell me to be grateful for things, and I felt upset with myself because I didn't feel like I fully grasped what gratitude was until I got it. I was like, oh shit, no, that's gratitude. That's gratitude. Because it's over joy.
Yeah.
So, yeah, man. Tells you, man. Always go back to gratitude.
What was your quote, Dil? Come on, leave us with this.
Quote. Damn, what was my quote? Hold on, give
damn,
me a
you
second.
Don't remember it?
No, I do. I wrote it down, but it was just, I was so, like, stuck on this, and like, se me fue el avión, you know? Okay. Nah, my quote was, a goal is only a dream if you don't act upon it. Because what do we do when we dream? We just sleep.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Amen.
Wish upon. Is there a quote that you live... You live by, you remember?
There's many. I believe in yourself and others will believe in you, ... eventually. Life is a gamble and I'm all in. To remind yourself to take risks. How you do anything is how you do everything. That's really big. So whether it's being a friend, being a companion, in every aspect, give it your all, 100%. You could either be right or you could be happy.
Sheesh. Okay. Right?
So okay. So many people are so focused on being right that they're never happy because they just want to be right. No matter. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So there's several. I'm working on an apparel line right now that I'm looking to inspire people through clothing, through apparel. Leave it at that. But then this is something that I've been holding back for like 10 years. I've just been talking about, my friends know about it, but I'm ready to go ahead and I have the belief in myself to go ahead and get it out there. The whole purpose of it is to empower people through apparel.
And to leave everybody with that, I mean, find, even in your darkest times, find the light and then hang on to it and keep walking towards it. And I promise
create your own path, baby.
Create your own path. JJ, appreciate you, man.
Thank you so much.
Thank you guys for having me. Again, I'm fucking excited for the journey that you guys are on.
Hey, he's going for round two. We're about to go for round two later.
I think that this was a part one of something that's going to come at a later time that we're all going to sit down once again. We're going to be like, damn, you remember this conversation we just had? And look at us now with the clothing line you're going to come out with. You know, us also having our clothing line that we're coming out with.
Yeah.
Yeah, man, this was powerful. Again, everybody thinks that we're just gonna talk about their job and what they do. Nah, man, this was we tried to dig a little bit.
And big up, oh shit, let me say, big ups to Concrete. I've been watching him do shit for years. I did this movie back. I met him on this movie called Philly Brown that I did with Gina Rodriguez back in the day, and Emilio was on that. And I'm so fucking proud of him and how hard he's hustled. And I don't even know the full scope of everything he's been through, but just from what I've seen, man, I'm so fucking proud of him. I'm proud of Emilio. Emilio's been through. These are people that have been through shit, and look where they're at. Because they've been through shit. You know what I'm saying? Other Jesse Garcia, blow him up. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. He's been on his grind for years, man. Again, so don't fuck it. Be your own hero. If you're gonna, you've been a victim of shit, but also be your own goddamn hero. You feel me?
That's it. Leave it at that. Baby, it's also like podcast. Everybody know. Make sure you subscribe, share, like, man, do the damn thing. Appreciate everybody. Let's go.